Nothing in this case is as it seems, but that's what happens on the internet, you see.
You're an absolute gem. Thank you for clicking on this video. I'm Brooke Makenna, but this is about an online love triangle that led to murder. Now, the secrets that are going to be exposed in this case will absolutely blow your mind. By the way, I'm continuing my suspect series throughout August, so if you want more videos like this, make sure to thumbs up and make sure you're subscribed down below. Now let's get back to the story. So this all began in May of 2005 and on an online site called Pogo. There was teen chat rooms on there, and there was a user under the name Talhotblond Big 50. Now the tall had one L in it and the blonde was without an E, and her profile picture showed a beautiful blonde young girl. And this user began messaging with another user under Marine Sniper 1000, and they really started to hit it off. They got to know each other very quickly, and Talhotblond told Marine Sniper her real name was Jessie and that she was an athletic softball playing high school senior from West Virginia. Marine Sniper told Jessie that his real name was Tommy and that he was also 18 and using his father's account. He also said that he was an Iraq-bound Marine who was 6 foot tall with red hair and very big muscles. Even after the descriptions, they still wanted to see more of each other, so they began to send pictures back and forth. Jessie would send pictures of her, you know, in prom dresses and when she was all fancy or just in athletic gear, and then a few swimsuit pictures as well, and Tommy would send pictures of himself when he was in the Marine boot camp in his uniform, and they did this quite often. This flirtation led to a deeper connection over the next few months, where Tommy was telling Jessie about his stories of when he was in combat. Jessie was buying heart pendants that said Jessie and Tommy forever, and there quickly began talk of marriage between the two of them. Not only did they talk online during this time, they also sent gifts to each other, love letters, and they talked on the phone. Jessie once wrote in a love letter that, "I'll love you forever and always, Tommy," to which he responded, "I've never felt this way." Now, while Tommy was off in war at Paris Island, his father actually continued communication with Jessie and often tried to get them to break it off between the two of them, or get her to break it off between the two of them. At one point, when Tommy was back and talking to Jessie, Jessie's mother wanted to talk to him, but despite the parents' involvement, they still wanted to be with each other and continue to talk. After this, they began talking dirtier to each other. It got even to a deeper level of the relationship, and Jessie actually sent Tommy one of her thongs in the mail. Tommy knew that Jessie was a virgin, and this very obviously intrigued him, and they talked about sex a lot during their time, and even you could call it virtual sex, phone sex, stuff like that. But after almost a year into their online relationship, Tommy proposed to Jessie and she said yes, but this was before they ever even met each other. Jessie was about to meet Tommy in a far stranger circumstance than she could have ever expected. In February or March of 2006, Jessie received a photo and a letter in the mail. The photo was of a family, a mom and dad with their two daughters, and a letter. And in this letter, it described who was in that photo. And it said, "Let me introduce you to these people. The man in the center is Tom, my husband since 1989. He is 46 years old." Then it went on to say, "Do not trust words on a computer. Let this go. You will only be hurt by a man who has mastered the art of manipulations and lies." Then it came out that Tommy was not an 18-year-old. He was a 46-year-old man named Tom Montgomery, and he was pretending to be Tommy and Tommy's father. So Tommy, whose real name was Tom, had a wife named Cindy Montgomery of 17 years. She had kind of speculated that something was going on after she had seen Tom at the computer so often and would try to talk to him, and he would say, "After I'm done with this," and it would be on the computer for hours at a time. But it wasn't until one of their daughters was on the computer that Tom normally used, when Jessie messaged him, that it was basically confirmed. After that, the daughter went to get her mother, who then went searching for other clues and other proof that this affair was happening, and that is when she found the love letters the pictures and the red thong. And that's when she decided to go ahead and write Jesse this letter to basically warn her and tell her the truth. But the most disturbing find of all was a note that Tom had written to himself. And it said, "On January 2nd, 2006, Tom Montgomery, 46 years old, ceases to exist and is replaced by an 18-year-old battle-scarred Marine. He is moving to West Virginia to be with the love of his life." Tom thought of this Tommy that he had created in his mind, of a red-haired Harrison Ford with $2.5 million in the bank and a 9-inch penis. Tom said that this virtual sex made him feel dirty, but he couldn't stop. He couldn't sever the ties once he began because it was almost like a drug that he needed every day. Each message, he was very clearly losing his grip on reality, and you could see the rage in his messages when things weren't going his way. But Jesse actually didn't mind, and so he continued being that way. Initially, when this 18-year-old beautiful girl messaged Tom, he thought, well, I'm never going to meet her, so I might as well just play this game. But that spiraled into so much more. The pictures he sent of himself were of himself back when he served in the military for 6 years when he was so much younger. He sent those pictures because the truth was he was a 46-year-old husband of two who lived in Buffalo, New York, pretending to be an 18-year-old boy. In real life, he was the typical middle-aged man with a dad bod, a mustache, and a balding head. He worked at a factory called Dynabraid Corporation that made power tools, and he often went to play poker with his friends. He really seemed like a normal guy, all until Jesse came along. And fast forward a year later, he was in a full-blown relationship with someone online that was far younger than him. Upon receiving this letter, Jesse actually broke off the whole thing with Tom, or Tommy, almost immediately, saying that he should go to jail for this. But at the same time, Jesse wasn't sure that she believed this whole thing from Tom's wife. So she decided to contact a coworker of Tom's to see if this whole thing was true. Now, he was a 22-year-old man named Brian Barrett, who was a part-time machinist and Buffalo State College student who was studying to be an arts teacher. He had coached Little League, he helped his father coach soccer. He was really kind of finding his place in the world, and that's when he began talking to Jesse. He went under the user Beefcake. And although the confirmation from Brian about Tom led to Jesse's disappointment, she really liked talking to Brian, and they began talking very frequently. They were obviously more the same age, it was more appropriate, and she really hit it off with him quickly. And even in just a little bit of time, she said, "My sweet Brian, I love you." Now, when Tom caught news of this, because they did work together, he messaged Jesse saying, "Brian will pay in blood." But again, Tom was always kind of angered soul and would say things like that all the time to Jesse, even before she knew who he really was. So this didn't really stand out that much to Jesse. And so Jesse and Brian actually went around on the website that they were all talking on, telling everybody who Tommy really was, who his real identity was, so he wouldn't do this to anyone else, which just made Tom even more angry. From the outside, it seemed that Jesse was completely done with Tom, but online, she was still messaging him. She would say things like, "I ache to be with Tommy. Do you miss it, Tom?" And he would reply with, "More than you will ever know. My heart aches to hear you call me Tommy. I wish I could be that 19-year-old Marine for you." But eventually, Jesse chose Brian over Tom, and this was Tom's breaking point. At work together, he would hear Brian bragging about it, saying that he was the chosen one that was going to pop her cherry, and this just fueled Tom's fire even more. He began making threats against Brian and Jesse's mother, saying that he wouldn't leave shell casings around if he were to murder somebody, and he didn't seem like he was joking. Then Brian decided that he wanted to actually meet Jesse in person, and so after a work trip on his way home that would have been through West Virginia, he asked if he could stop by and see her. He was going to, and then at the last minute, Jesse said that he really couldn't, and so he didn't. But by that time, Tom had already heard that he was going to meet Jesse, the woman that Tom would never get to meet. And again, Tom messaged Jesse, this time saying, "By continuing contact with him, you've done what I feared most. You turn my heart, ice cold. And then on September 15th of 2006, Brian Barrett was found dead in the factory parking lot where they both worked. 2 days prior to that, at 10 p.m., he was walking outside of work after a shift when he was shot 3 times in the neck and the arm. A military rifle was used, and it was described as a sniper-style shooting, and the police believed that someone wore a mask when they did it, and they also did it at very close range. And they also used a .30 caliber rifle. When coworkers were questioned, they quickly told the police about the Brian, Tom, Jesse love triangle that they had heard so much about. And so when the police went to search for Tom, they could not find him anywhere. So they decided to search his computer instead, and that's when they found all of the conversations between him and Jesse. Upon reading them, their concern for Jesse's life grew quickly. Could he be after her next? They quickly called for officers to be dispatched to Oak Hill, West Virginia, where she lived. It was the Sheeler residence, and the mother of the house, Mary Sheeler, opened the door at about 6 or 6:30 that evening. The police asked her if they could speak to her daughter, Jessie, if she was home, but that's not who they really wanted to talk to. Only Mary knew that, though. She began to get very nervous, her eyes were getting watery, when she finally admitted the truth, that Jesse wasn't talking to these men. She was. She knew the lies had to stop, and so this 45-year-old mother of two came clean that she was Jesse, and that she had been using her daughter Jesse's pictures the whole time. The real Jesse had never communicated with Brian or Tom or anybody that she had been talking to, and this had been going on for years. Jesse also had no idea that her mother was doing this, and her mother would take pictures of her without her consent, and also stuck a video camera up her skirt at one point to film underneath to send to guys asking, "Do you like it?" Because to Jesse, Mary was a wonderful mother who was basically her friend. They were a team. They would go get their nails done. They would go prom dress shopping together. And she loved her. She had no idea that her mother, Mary, could be behind this sort of deception. And when Mary was caught, she said she was just having fun playing games. Tom had called Jesse, who was really Mary, to tell her that Brian was easy to take care of right after Brian was murdered. And so this woman who just thought she was playing games was now the cause of a murder and a murderer on the loose. When they finally found Tom Montgomery, they began building the strongest case they could against him because he was not confessing. They had his DNA at the crime scene on a peach pit and a gun clip. They had a motive, and they found an old family photo of Cindy where in the back of the room you could see a gun cabinet with the very gun that was used on Brian. Tom at first said he had an alibi that he was home all night and his family would back that up. Cindy refused to, and after talking to his daughters, he didn't want to make them lie either. While being investigated, they of course found out that Jesse was actually Mary, and they showed Tom a picture of the lady that he had murdered for. Color drained from his face and he went completely silent, and then later on when he was in prison tried to commit suicide, but still refused to confess to what he had done. His defense really tried to plead insanity for him, but there was not enough to go on. So finally they entered a plea deal where Tom Montgomery would plead guilty to the first degree manslaughter charge of Brian Barrett for a 20-year sentence. His wife Cindy divorced him, and as for his kids, at the time of the trial, they were still talking to him, but I'm not sure if they're still to this day. But Jesse, or Mary, who she really was, her entire family stopped contact altogether. Her husband Tim divorced her, and her daughters refused to acknowledge her at all. She didn't even tell them about what she had done. Jesse had to Google it and see that her mother's name was all over news reports and online saying that she was a catfish and that she was involved in a murder charge. And that's when Jesse found out that not only was that true, also her mother had used her own pictures. Jesse, the real Jesse, feeling betrayed after seeing this, went to her father asking if he knew about it, and he had to persuade her that he didn't, because he really didn't. There was an interview that I watched of him where he was crying and saying that him and Mary had a good marriage, and that, I mean, they were together for a while and he didn't He wanted to spend the rest of his life with her. He had no idea that this was all going on behind the scenes. Jesse asked her father why her mother would do this, and he told her because Mary believes that if she can get away with something, she'll do it. She'll do anything. And when she was younger, actually, that was her entire personality that people knew her as. She could get away with anything. She was a great liar, and her mother actually caught her at one point sticking her finger in her eye to make it look like she was crying so she could get out of a punishment. But she was never charged for anything she did because the police couldn't build a case on anything she did. Nothing she did was illegal, unfortunately. And so she was just free to go. But what she did was enough for her daughter Jessie to cut ties with her completely and move in with other relatives to continue college. Mary never apologized for what she had done to Jessie and only cares about writing her book. The book is supposedly about the dangers of the internet, but to me it just sounds like a way to get more fame and get more money out of what she's done. Mary's ex-husband, Tim, said that her going to prison would be the only way that she would realize that she did something wrong. Mary, though, says that the only reason she was talking to Tom was because she was trying to get him not to talk to other teens. But Jesse wasn't Mary and Tim's only kid. They actually had a son named Tim Jr., who recently had an interview saying that he was worried because his mother was spending a lot of time on the internet again. And Tom Montgomery has actually appealed his case, saying that he was forced to take that plea. But I couldn't find anywhere if that's actually going anywhere or if anything's going to happen with that. Brian Barrett's parents actually started a petition shortly after his death trying to enact laws to protect against future Mary Sheelers, but nothing was really done, and still catfishing to this day is not illegal. Nothing to do with really internet safety is in the laws yet, which is just insane to me that we haven't evolved yet and seen how much damage that somebody can do online. I mean, do you believe that catfishing should be legal, or stuff on the internet should be more looked into and put more into the laws nowadays, or what do you think on the whole thing? I don't really know much about it, so if there is anything that's kind of like that that's come about more recently, please let me know. I'd love to learn about it and sign any petitions to get that going. I couldn't find Brian Barrett's petition that his parents started anymore, unfortunately, but I definitely think that something has to change. But what would you do if your mother used your pictures to catfish? How would you handle that? Would you handle it like Jesse, completely cut her off? Would you forgive her? What would you do? And have you ever known or been a catfish? I'd love to hear your stories down below. This story was actually turned into a Lifetime movie called Talhotblond because of the insane twists and turns in the stories. I mean, and it was a pretty popular thing, just like the show Catfish, where they actually search for these people who are catfishing. It's so intriguing because it's strange to see somebody wanting to be and pretending to be someone other than themselves. I think it's something we all wish we could do, but is it something we should be doing? Probably not. So I want to take this story and turn it into a message for any young people or even older people out there watching about internet safety, especially when you are talking to, you know, a love interest or someone that you are flirting with just because you find them attractive or that they seem like they would never talk to you in real life. Don't ignore the red flags just because you like them. You know, there are many ways to see if a person's real or not. The one I always go to is Snapchat. It's very hard to pretend that you're someone else on Snapchat because you're instantly taking that picture. So always, it's a quick and easy thing. Ask them for their Snapchat. Ask them for a picture. If they still won't send a picture of themselves, they're probably a catfish. There are very easy ways to learn about stuff like that without being so upfront. And if it's a little scary to ask, please, if you are just talking to someone who really seems like a catfish because you like the attention, know that that's just going to end in your heartache. So please, you know, really research into who they are. Look at their friends, at their photos. Do they have multiple different photos? Do they use the same ones? Do they look fake? Do they look too good to be true? Just be cautious, and I don't want you to have trust issues about it, but just really know who you're talking to before you get invested. And if you are a catfish out there, if you do catfish, please look yourself in the mirror right now and know that somebody out there will love you for you. You don't have to pretend to be somebody else, because someone's going to love the real you. And why would you put yourself through the heartbreak of pretending to be somebody else? Because you'll never get to actually love that person and be with them, because they don't know who you really are. But the craziest part of this case to me is that Tom and Mary were so alike in real life, even though they were pretending. Both of them were, because they were both around the same age, they both had kids, they were both in marriages they didn't like. They probably, if they met on the street, would have gotten along. Maybe if they were divorced and ready to, you know, date again, it would have all been a beautiful love story instead of this tragic ending and a murder and jail time and families being ripped apart. They could have had a love story, you know. It could have been meant to be in a different way if they would have just waited for it and done the right thing. And then maybe an innocent man wouldn't have lost his life. So please be careful on the internet and know that not everything is as it seems. And you shouldn't always just be trusting. Be cautious and be safe out there, because I do love each and every one of you, and I wouldn't want any of you to be hurt, whether it's physically or mentally or emotionally. Now please thumbs up if you want more videos like this, and I'll continue to do them for you. Now don't ever forget to speak up. Your voice is powerful enough, and I love you to absolute pieces. Okay, bye.
Such a thin screen between us all. Sometimes it's a good thing, and sometimes we wish it was a concrete wall.